Throughout the last few decades, economists and socialists have pointed to Cuba as an example of a socialist failure. But lately, social media leftists have taken a more revisionist approach. They believe Cuba proves socialism works. They point to things like infant mortality rates, life expectancies, and literacy rates, without actually understanding the history or context behind these things. So let's take a closer look at this proclaimed socialist success. Dr. Benjamin Powell is a professor of economics at Rawls College of Business. Him and two other researchers dug into Cuban healthcare statistics and published a paper entitled Cuban Infant Mortality and Longevity, Healthcare or Repression.
So everybody knows that Cuba's economy has been stagnant for decades, but socialists who look at it and say, well, at least one thing's good, their healthcare. Cubans have long life expectancies. So socialist healthcare works in Cuba. We have to understand the system there. First of all, there's three different systems. One for the ruling elite in the Communist Party. Another for medical tourists traveling from places like Canada or Europe and others to get treatment there where they pay the government doctors for that treatment. And then the third is for normal people in Cuba. The one with the normal people in Cuba is horrible. People even bring their own sheets or basic necessities with them when they're going to stay in the hospital. So somehow when we look at statistics that say Cuban life expectancy is as long or even longer than the United States, this doesn't pass the smell test. There's something else going on. Now, it is true that a socialist economy can devote a lot of resources to, well, any one activity, but medicine per se, versus everything else. I mean, the Soviets could have a successful space program and get a cosmonaut in space before the United States. But meanwhile, the average Soviet was waiting in a bread line and had a miserable standard of living. Same true in Cuba. They can invest more in medicine at the expense of people not being able to satisfy their other desires that they would choose if it weren't being forced into medicine. That said, it's still probably an overstatement of what's going on with their life expectancies there because they kind of cook the books. One thing that happens in Cuba is high-risk pregnancies are aborted before they actually get to birth. So if you have an abortion, that doesn't count into your life expectancy statistics. However, if a high-risk baby is born and dies in its first week or year, that does go into your life expectancy statistics. And because it's a very young birth, that's going to really pull down on your life expectancies. So Cuba has a rate of abortion much higher than anywhere else that you could compare it to. And that's because the doctors there who get evaluated in part about their life expectancy of children after it's born, basically cook the books and force women with high-risk pregnancies into having abortions that they might not otherwise have. Now, that doesn't explain everything, but once you start adjusting for that, Cuba, instead of looking like a complete outlier in North America, starts looking like a pretty good life expectancy, but not as crazy as what it otherwise would, which jives a little bit better with them forcing more resources into medicine. Now, it's also the case, too, that Cuban government doesn't deliver on lots of things that can be fun that would lower your life expectancy. Great steak and other things that can lead to heart disease are not plentiful there. So there are ways that life expectancy might go up while your actual lived standard of living goes down. And some of that's going on in Cuba too. So the punchline is a socialist economy is desperately inefficient. It can force resources into one industry like healthcare or education that raises rates of life expectancy or literacy at the expense of making other people better off. But also, even on those margins, it's not as good as what the Cuban government tries to present it as.
In their research, Dr. Powell and his colleagues also pointed out other important pieces of information, such as car ownership in Cuba. Cuba's car ownership rate is 55.8 per 1,000 people, compared to Latin America's average of 267. Car accidents are often large contributors to overall country fatalities. In Brazil, for example, the car ownership rate is 7.3 times that of Cuba. Road fatalities reduce male and female life expectancy at birth by 0.8 and 0.2 years. A healthcare system is not the only thing that contributes to life expectancy. The way people act, the technology that exists, can often contribute way more than healthcare itself. There's also different ways in which countries measure certain things, such as infant mortality rates. Reporting requirements vary vastly across different countries. So that's why it's important to always have context and history to these surface-level numbers. With all of that being said, let's look a little deeper into Cuba's statistics. Claims about literacy rates are also greatly exaggerated. Even before the revolution, Cuba had a high literacy rate relative to the rest of Latin America. Now we get to modern Cuba. Currently, there are large-scale anti-government protests. This has brought up a lot of talk about socialism, sanctions, and more.
So Cuban socialism has been around since 1959, and it's looking like there's finally some possibility for change, both change made by the regime and change being demanded by the people. And that's very encouraging. So no economy is purely socialist or purely capitalist. And by this, we mean the state owning all of the factors of production, the businesses, the enterprises. Cuba is pretty far down that socialist spectrum, but over time, they allowed small-scale private businesses to open up. You can have privately owned restaurants. You can rent out your flat where you live for a profitable business to compete with state-owned hotels. And more recently, in February of this year, the Cuban government announced a major reform where they were going to allow for what they call private employment, but what it basically means is small-scale private business in a lot more industries, reserving a lot smaller number, only around 100 or so, for exclusively state enterprises. Now, if that could grow, the path of Cuban reform, while the Communist Party remains in power, might look something more like China, who started its reforms in 1978 and maintained the Communist political party's monopoly, but kind of grew a private sector around the existing state sector so that by the time we got to the early 2000s, the private sector was vastly bigger than the state sector in terms of organizing production and output in China, so that it would be a mistake to say that they had a socialist economy. Now, they didn't have free market capitalism. They have a crony capitalist economy now, mixed with the Communist Party's political control. And if those reforms made by the regime in Cuba continue in that direction, it has a lot of the flavor of how China's economy became more capitalist than it is socialist while the party maintains control. However, perhaps even more encouraging, recently, Cubans taking to the street and demanding, chanting, freedom, 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 because of the dire situation that many of them are in. The Cuban economy has been stagnant for decades, but during COVID, it shrunk dramatically, about 11, 12% probably. Although, to be honest, all economic statistics in socialist countries are kind of bogus because we don't have market prices. But in any event, it shrunk dramatically so that there's food lines, there's shortages, that people are upset with this, but they're protesting and not demanding handouts. They're demanding reform, freedom, in order to have a system that can deliver these things more. And this has been the biggest protest in Cuba since at least the early 1990s. It's very uncertain of how it will play out at this point. But if that's the case, then maybe even more substantial change than what we've been seeing from the regime could come. And I'll say, if we have anything in the United States to say about this, the best thing that the United States could do is just end its disastrous embargo on Cuba. Because, of course, how did the government respond to these protests? Well, they blame the United States. They say our economic problems come from the, they call it a blockade. Of course, it's not a blockade. There is no destroyer preventing Kias from going into Cuba. It's an embargo. It's a prevention of business from the United States interacting with Cuba. But they blame their problems on our embargo. So the United States should end this blame game and just say, we're done with the embargo. We're going to allow Cubans and Americans to trade freely with each other, Americans to travel there. This would end some of Cuba's misery on the margin, but the embargo is not the big reason for Cuban suffering. It's their own socialist economy. The problems they have today that are causing protests would remain even with trade with the United States, but it would make it more plain for everybody to see that their problems are homegrown and can't be blamed on a capitalist outsider United States. And as an added bonus, if people are successful in actually securing greater freedom there, well, if they already have free trade and free investment in place with the United States, Cuban growth would take off. The United States would inject it with the funds that would allow it to grow rapidly and get Cubans out of poverty in a way that proves the superiority of a free market system to the socialist regime that had perpetuated poverty for generations in Cuba.
In 2017, the entire GDP of Cuba was $137 billion. The effects of the embargo is estimated at $685 million a year. This is 0.5% of the entire GDP. Looking at Cuba's exports, Venezuela makes up 17.8%, Spain, 12.1%, Russia, 7.9%, Lebanon, 6.1%, Indonesia, 4.5%, Germany, 4.3%. And those are the 2017 numbers. The total in exports was $2.63 billion. Looking at imports, China was 22%, Spain was 14%, Russia was 5%, Brazil 5%, Mexico 4.9%, Italy 4.8%, and the United States 4.5%. So any claims that Cuba does not trade with the rest of the world are completely unfounded. Now, if we lifted the embargo years ago, or we lift it today, would the Cuban government actually be responsible enough to improve things? The answer is no, they are corrupt and bad business partners. Cuba generally has a poor track record as being a borrower and business partner. Within the last 5 years alone, Cuba's debtors have written off more than $400 billion in debt as uncollectible. This is the equivalent of the US failing to pay $8 trillion in debt. There are now fewer than 250 foreign companies doing business in Cuba, and this number is only expected to decline as more partners give up along the way. Looking at these facts, it is clear that although the US embargo does have significant negative effects, it does not tell the whole story. Cuba's government is corrupt and evil, and they have failed their people. Moving forward, it is important, number one, to end the embargo. First of all, this restricts the freedom of Americans and Cubans. Secondly, it unnecessarily hurts Cubans. And thirdly, it gives the Cuban government and American socialist revisionists an excuse. We should encourage the Cuban government to embrace a free society and free markets so that we can start seeing the Cuban people rise out of poverty. Or we can offer a trade. American socialists for Cuban freedom lovers. I think that would be fair.